Well, just to catch everyone up, we ended on a bit of a oh fuck, what the hell was happening kind of moment, where Eirnin and Vic both got pulled out of reality and thrown back into it, with Eirnin specifically discovering that she'd lost time and vanished right in front of Busey. And we were about to resolve just one or two things before we kick off with everything else, which was, does Eirnin manage to hold her form after such a traumatic event?
Hey!
Yay, trauma!
I completely fucked. I said, am I completely fucked?
So could you give me a fit in? So that would be roll plus fake.
I would argue that this isn't a fit in.
This You're trying strange. To fit into a mortal situation, perform yes. mundane task, or deflect suspicion.
But I am not performing a mundane task. I am trying to not to physically shift my form into a. Sorry, I'm not trying to be like rules lawyering you, but it feels to me like using my magical powers to transform myself is not the same as using my intellect to.
Well, the thing is, fake is not necessarily just your. Like interpersonal savviness, it's your holistic ability to fit in. And while I definitely do appreciate that it is using your magical powers, this is not using them in an unusual or esoteric way. This is just trying to do the thing you do normally to stop people going, "What the fuck is a walking supernova doing coming down the high street?"
Okay, no fair. All right, let's get my voice into character. Sorry about that.
That's cool.
Right, I'm gonna roll. So that would be plus zero fit in, yeah.
Yep.
That's a 7. No, 8. My bad.
Oh, that's cool. Yeah, that's fine. So you get close, but you make a last minute error, social slip, or give something away. I think your essence and veil are where they need to be.
No, I need to heal an essence.
Oh, yeah, well then heal an essence. But yeah, I'm going to make a move against you. So. Actually, no. You know what? I'll actually keep that in reserve.
Is that a thing you can do?
I can hold a move.
You're a bitch. Unforeseen consequences.
Absolutely. I'm just going to put plus one move in bold down here on the bottom of my notes. Lovely stuff. You have a momentary lap. You have a momentary kind of rush of uncertainty as you snap back and see Buse's confused, slightly frenetic expression. And just for a moment, you feel like you're about to let everything slip. That this just... You want to be elsewhere. You want to fucking vanish and just... You want to find somewhere dark and quiet to just not be for a while. But you stop.
Mood.
Take a moment. Get it back under control. And,
okay.
Busey just rubs her face a couple of times. Oh. Am I having a moment here?
What do you mean?
I could have sworn. No, never mind. I should be
okay.
I should drink some more water. Fuck.
Are you okay? Do you need? Do you want me to get you something to drink?
Could you?
Okay. I get up and go and get a drink.
Yeah. Busey just looks over at the half-empty bottle of Jim Beam that she'd been going through and goes, "Yeah, I think that's enough."
Okay. Do we need to do anything past that, or is there a...
I would ask you just a fairly simple question. Are you going to spend the rest of the night over in the camp, or are you going to head back to your trailer?
I think I have a cabin, not a trailer, but... either way.
Yeah.
I can't remember. I can check on my sheet.
No, I think you said a cabin. It's fine.
What is the rest of the group doing?
So for the moment, the rest of the guys are effectively... battening down for the night. Zachariah and Trevor are the only two really still getting the last minute touches done to the buggy. The parts you saw from the last time have been pretty easily to just snap into place, get the whole thing wired up and running, and there's a few loud barks
children,
from the engine.
Children GBH parts. Yeah, I'm just going to head back. I'm going to ask if Busey wants to come back to my place. She seems a little bit shaken.
Yeah, I would say like while everything's winding down, Clovis and Kate are kind of handing out dinner for everyone. Trevor's noodling with his guitar by the fire. Busey just, without really saying anything, just catches Clovis's eye. He nods, and she just kind of tucks an arm around yours and just leans into you slightly.
I send Trevor a text and say, if you need anything, let me know. We can we should schedule catching up sometime this week.
Yeah, you
just to be like engaging, I guess.
Yeah, no, his phone. You can hear his phone go off from where he's been sitting, but he just keeps on with his guitar for the moment.
Okay, I turn and give him a look.
Yeah, he kind of catches your eye, smiles.
Okay, then I head back to my trailer, and I guess that's the end of that scene.
Yeah, yeah. I would say, along the way back home, you are kind of walking, I'm assuming, at this point.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, as the night is winding down, Kaleep is starting to pick up a lot more. While everyone was quite clearly kind of in the hustle and bustle of setting up their buggies, it's now party time, and the bars are open, the Close Encounters Bar and Grill is absolutely heaving with people out front just drinking out of bags, eating burgers, making a fool out of themselves. You can see that the Desert Spice is still closed. And there is actually a sheriff's deputy just standing outside talking with Uke.
Oh dear. Don't talk to police.
He's going to give them a wide berth.
I'm not going anywhere near that.
There's actually, when you've actually kind of start noticing, there are actually quite a few of the sheriff's deputies just out on patrol, just walking along the sidewalk.
Is there a small off license I can go into?
Oh yeah, there's a couple of liquor stores and places like that you could quite easily. So, it's a Mormon town, but at the same time, it's a desert shithole where you need shit to pass the time.
So I get a cheap bottle of wine for me and Busey to share back at mine. I guess that takes off of the $20 that I got given earlier.
Yeah, you'd be paying like, I mean, it's probably like not $2 chuck. It's like $5-6. Yeah.
Yeah, like $5. Yeah. So I head back to mine with Busey and. Can I keep an eye out for anything suspicious or interesting?
Well, you're up in the peaks, aren't you?
Yeah, wherever you put the camera, yeah. I'm not sure.
Pretty much the peaks are one big area with lots of different trailer parks and stuff like that around it, so
yeah,
it's mostly just very cheap land you could pitch up on without having to worry about like major issues, but people privately own certain plots, hence you being screwed by your rent.
Well, okay, so we didn't see anything in the town that looked suspicious or anything like that, that's sort of what I was asking.
No, you don't. As you're going out of town, though, you do kind of swing by the big old trailer park with the crappy old bear outside of it.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of activity up there. You see people wandering around with flashlights. You see most of the trailers have still got the lights on, even late into the evening. And it's pretty clear, even from a distance, but over the desert night air, you just hear a woman crying.
Is there... Can I see any weapons?
Couple of the guys have got scatter guns, but they're just kind of holding them loosely at their sides. They're just mostly holding them for the fact that it makes them feel safer.
Okay, so I don't assess them as being a threat at all. Well,
no, they're
as
just,
much as anyone with a gun could be not a threat.
Yeah, you can kind of, from a distance, you can kind of see, like, a lot of the women have clustered together, a lot of the men and kind of younger men have just kind of started spreading out, checking in bushes, checking under cars, turning shit over.
Okay, I put this in the group chat about this activity because it looks kind of suspicious.
Yeah, and are you just gonna have a quiet night in?
Yeah, that's pretty much. I put that in the group chat, and then we head home and be boring couples. And that's it. I guess we can go over. Yeah, that was cute.
Speaking of going home, Vic.
Yo.
Last time we saw you, you were standing over a corpse and had just recently popped back into reality.
Yeah.
With a backpack full of skag and a dead man's cowboy boots on.
All right.
You still have to run this back to Petty.
Yeah.
Or at least get the information to him that you found it. Are you just going to be heading straight back to the Bar and Grill to find him again? Or are you going to call him up to get a lift?
How much... I remember I had some... food and drink in the bags.
Yeah, you had like a 6-pack of water, a couple of bags of beef jerky. You've probably made a bit of a dent in it, but, you know, being a heroin addict, you tend not to have much of an appetite.
Yeah, then I'll just walk back to the Bar and Grill.
Yeah, that's fair enough. Yeah, the trek back through the flats is a lot nicer now that the air's starting to cool quite significantly.
Oh, yeah.
And yeah, you don't feel anything really as you're walking back up the road. The haze from the dope is still doing its job, keeping everything at bay. And as you head back into town and head towards the Bar and Grill, you see the same thing that Eirnin did. You see these just crowds and crowds of drunk, kind of drugged out of their heads partygoers making any excuse to have a good time, thrashing around on the streets, hanging out basically anywhere they can sit down and smoke and drink. And yeah, you notice the same old panel van that Petty was driving earlier, parked at the back of the Bar and Grill where you saw him last time.
Right.
And yeah, if you head over, you just see him sitting there in the cab of the van, drumming his hands on the steering wheel, just looking vacantly out at nothing.
All right. Then I guess I'll just approach him and sit down where he's at.
Yeah, that's fair enough. You're actually going to get, like, yeah, he notices you on the way and he just pops the passenger side door out.
All right.
He goes, he just leans over to you and goes, hey, you got it?
Yeah, I got it. I got the entire thing.
Nice, nice. Just throw it in here. Fucking cops are everywhere tonight. I'm going to have to probably find somewhere to stick this. You should probably just get back home as soon as you can.
All right, sounds good, man. Here is the stuff.
Nice.
And I will see you later, but first give me my cash.
Yeah, fucking hell. He kind of pops open the glove compartment, sticks the bag in there, pulls out a small roll of bills, and tosses it towards you. And as he does, well, actually, he doesn't toss it straight away. He kind of holds it, looks at you and goes, wouldn't be any reason why those big fucking buck rednecks were looking to kick your asses there. There's been a lot of angry fucking hillbillies running around the place this evening.
Well, you see, as I said last time, it was self-defense. I was defending myself, and they jumped me and they tried to rob me.
You know I told you not to start any shit going up there.
You know, I mean, I can't help it if the inbreds try to rob me out of nowhere, you know? I'm an easy target. Look at me. I got marks all over my arms.
Vic, look at me. And his face gets a lot more plain and serious. Did you fucking kill that kid?
Oh my god, no, I fucking decked him in the face once. I literally punched him in the face once, ran to the bike, and just fucking hightailed it.
Could
he
you
had a baseball bat. He'll be
could
fine.
Could you give me plus real to open up?
Alright, plus...
Because Petty genuinely is not sure if he should believe you.
Alright, I have a 5 die and a 6 die.
Oh fuck, so you get like 13? In total?
Right.
Yeah, so that's perfect. So, yeah, you tell the truth. No, he's got...
Well, let me check.
Yeah, he's got plus 2 real.
I have plus 2 real. I have minus 1 strange, though.
Yeah, no, see, yeah, if you're rolling plus, if you're doing open up, then, yeah. You're actually quite good at being honest for a drug addict, or at least being convincingly honest.
Surprisingly.
Yeah. So, yeah, Petty just kind of looks at you for a long time, sighs, nods, because, yeah, I didn't think he would. Just watch yourself. Whatever you did to that kid, he's fucking vanished. And every single inbred motherfucker up on that hill is looking for you.
Oh, the kid'll be fine. Just a couple stitches.
No, I mean he's fucking... Like, I've been getting calls all fucking afternoon asking if I've seen that kid, if he tried to score off me, all kinds of shit.
Well, I didn't kill him, I just knocked him out. Like, he should be in the fucking trailer or whatever, man. Was he not there? Is he? I didn't fucking kill him. I only decked him in the face.
No. I believe you. Fucking for some fucking reason. Just, I'll cut. Look, if they ask, I'll cover for you. I'll say I haven't seen you, but just know they've got a hard on out for you, and I can't really slow that shit down. Maybe keep an eye open.
We'll,
if you find
we'll deal
anything,
with the problem as it comes along.
Yeah, just tosses the roll of bills to you. Just look after yourself, all right?
Yeah,
you're
gotcha.
A fucking degenerate, but you do good work, I guess.
Yeah, thanks, Dad. See you later.
Proud of you, son. slams the door and drives off.
Well, alright, I guess I'll find my way back. I might as well pick up the loot I got from the place too, see if I can cash it in or something.
Yeah, you've got a few bits of you've got like a pistol with a couple of rounds in it and a folding knife and a bunch of other shit.
Hell but, yeah.
You've also got the bills you stashed in the P.O. box, but that place is closed at this time of evening.
Oh, fuck. All right, well, I guess I didn't think about that. Then I guess I'll just go back to my my flat real quick and board it up.
Well, your standard barricading, then.
Yeah, with the standard barricading. Yeah, at least
that's
I can...
fair enough.
Roll for standard barricade.
All right, shit.
No. Basically, just to peel back the curtain here for a second, if you'd failed at opening up, Petty was probably gonna was probably going to rat you out, but he actually thought you were sincere and doesn't see any point in fucking you over, so he's gonna keep your secret for the moment.
You're mean.
All right.
Look, drug dealers tend not to be the most altruistic of people.
Yeah, but they don't tend to be rats.
I mean, Sab's got a point, though. Dude, there's a lot of drug dealers who rat just to save their own skin, man.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know from experience, but, like...
Bitches.
Yeah.
Wow, okay. Bit
all right,
fucking
then,
harsh.
Then, yeah, I guess I'll go back to my flat. I'll board it up, and then I'm going to sit there and try to figure out what the fuck just happened in the desert. Because that's different from a possession.
So you actually just so I refresh your memory as well, when you did do your role back when the whole thing happened, you do remember that this was something to do with the old speed trials that happened in the 1940s. Some oil magnate called Nobel tried to break the land speed record and his car just fucking exploded the minute he turned it on.
Right, well, I understand it has something to do with that, but I don't think my character would understand. He probably just think it's like a fucking heroin.
Yeah, no, that's fair.
But, you know, yeah, then I guess I'll go back to my place and board it up.
Yeah, that's totally fair, and if you just want to get your head down and get some shut-eye, I don't blame you.
Hell yeah.
Yeah, you guys can crash out for the night. Nice, so... Time passes. Do a nice time-lapse photo of the sky. If there's a sky night, just pinwheeling back over to morning. Just black titles, day two. Alright, so yeah, day arrives, like a undercooked runny egg slopping through the cracks in your window, in your blinds in your window. And yeah, Vic wakes up, well, kind of is slowly roused back into consciousness by a lack of fatigue and probably rolling onto something sharp and unpleasant. You look up, open your eyes, kind of breaking the crust on them. And there's someone just sat over in the other corner of the room.
Pull out my gun and aim at them and then yell what the fuck they're doing in here. Do I look over at the door?
They're not by the door. I mean, you could look over at the door, but the
just
door
to
is
see
still...
if it's barricaded.
Door's still barricaded.
Yeah, then aim the gun and ask what the fuck they're doing.
Yeah, it takes you a couple of moments as your vision kind of realigns. You could have sworn you saw this guy before. Like, sandy blonde hair. Like, in his underpants, but with a bloody t-shirt on.
Alright.
Skin looks kind of sallow and pale. He doesn't... He looks at you and goes, "You got my fucking boots, you thieving junkie prick."
Oh, fuck. That you're alive? Do you still have the jacket at least?
He kind of looks around, kind of heaves himself up onto his feet. No.
How are you a fucking alive? You were dead. There's blood. I mean, here's your fucking cowboy boots. You can fucking keep them. They're a size too short for me anyways, but how the fuck are you alive?
You just gonna, like, throw them at him, or...?
Yeah, just throw them at him.
They just go straight through him.
Oh.
He just kind of goes, "Ah! The fuck?" Oh, yeah. Right.
So, you are not alive, or at least not physically.
Yeah, I. Why am I here?
I don't fucking know. Why the fuck are you in my apartment? Get the fuck out.
He just kind of rubs his face. Oh, fuck. Look, I've had a hell of a fucking evening. I am trying to get my shit together.
Okay.
Now, look.
Oh, alright.
Apparently, it's important that you took my boots. And you took my jeans? Why is this so important?
Well, I took the boots and the jeans because, to make a long story short, there's a bunch of inbreds who were after me because I punched a kid in the face, and then I thought, oh, maybe if I switched out my clothes for yours, then maybe they would think I died in the desert, and then I'd have, you know, a head start.
He just kind of looks down at his tighty whities and bare feet and goes, yeah, thanks.
Well, I didn't
I
know...
I get to spend eternity with my cock hanging out.
Well... I wasn't expecting you to appear in a fucking ghost form in my fucking apartment. That's kind of different. You imagine how I feel.
Well, I don't care. You stole my shit. God.
Take your fucking shit back. What, you want me to walk all the way into the fucking desert again and give you your clothes back?
I don't know. Look, I'm just trying to... It's like... I know it's important. I know I'm dead, but I don't feel bad. Why don't I feel bad? I'm dead. I should be fucking freaking out. All I am is pissed at you. Stealing my fucking boots.
Alright then.
Why am I so pissed at you stealing my fucking boots?
Well, tell you what. Maybe when I get some money, I'll get a cab or something. I'll go up there quick and I'll drop off your jeans and your boots and shit if you want them. You can... Oh, Jesus Christ. Who is it now? What the fuck?
Yeah, just from the other side of the door, you just kind of hear a... Victor Meyer? Could you open the door, please?
Who is it?
Sheriff's Department. Open up, please. Oh, got a couple of questions.
Jesus Christ. I want to hide my gun and all my shit underneath a floorboard.
Yeah, I would say that's... I was going to say, you've got enough nasty little rat holes around this apartment. That's pretty much a freebie.
Do you want... Okay, I was going to ask if you want me to roll. Alright. Then I do that. Sure. Then I guess I just open the door.
While you're kind of doing all this, the guy's just kind of putting his hands on his hips, watching you do this. Kind of walks over and stands behind you as you open the door. And as you open the door, you see this guy. Do give me a moment when I find the correct person. You see that handsome-looking gentleman, who you know and fucking fear as Paul Smith, eldest son to Mordecai Smith, one of the really influential Mormons around here, and also one of the most lethal sheriff deputies the town's ever known.
Well,
he's been over more close shootings than you've ever heard of.
Well, hi, Sheriff.
He's not. I'm not Sheriff.
Well, whatever the case is, what's the reason for the visit?
I was in the neighborhood. I was just running a couple of errands, and just had a feeling that I might want to talk to you about a couple of things.
Well, I guess I have no choice, considering your position of authority.
Yeah, I'm going to play it like that. It's fine. You don't happen to know where you were about between 6 to like 9 p.m. last night, would you?
I'm going to be honest. I don't remember most of my days, or nights for that matter.
No, that's fine. Just, I remember you having this really nice leather jacket.
Well,
kind of a long mid-length one. I thought it was always weird you wore that in the middle of the fucking summer and everything, but I don't like to judge. But you just SLPD picked up a body down by the tree, Utah, last night. Well, kind of early this morning, kind of like 1 a.m. And they found a bunch of just other shit lying around this half-naked body. And the jacket, I mean, to me, we haven't run prints or anything yet, but the jacket looked pretty familiar, so I was just wondering if you If you still got that jacket on you.
Well, now you're saying something. I do remember getting mugged by a bunch of inbreds out near the trailer park. Maybe one of them took my jacket. I don't know. It was a bit of a haze. You know, in a stupor. You know what I'm saying?
A couple too many track marks. I heard something went up there, but yeah, no one's filed any report, so none of my business until they decide to. But yeah, just keep your eyes open. You hear anything, he kind of pulls his card out, hands it over, and it's got just his phone, his cell number and his name. He goes, if you see or hear anything, just let me know.
Yeah.
You know, guy like you, habit you got, if I was to find you were involved in something like, you know, first degree murder, into possession with intent to supply. I mean, we got some real nice jails out here where you could go like 2-3 years before you even see the inside of a courtroom. He just leans in closer and goes, you know, a place where you just go cold turkey in a nice, cool, quiet room, just four walls.
Unfortunately, I hope that doesn't happen for either of our sakes, because I'm kind of a handful. I know you don't like babies.
Yeah. Well, keep your nose clean, and if you see anything, you ring me.
I'll make sure to ring you, Sheriff.
And yeah, he just gives you kind of a very kind of dry grin, gives you a finger gun, and walks off.
All right, let's board back up the room again.
Yeah, just behind you. You just hear, fuck. Fuck, that guy gives me the fucking creeps.
How are you even still
getting the creeps?
I don't even know, man, but fucking cops, dude. Fuck that. They just fucking weird me out. I don't like them. But regardless, I can't exactly go up there and drop off the nice clothes that I have now. But maybe, potentially, we can figure.
What do you mean? The fucking cops picked up my body. I'm probably somewhere in Salt Lake fucking City by now.
Well, maybe if you want, I could have. Okay, well, did you wake up at that specific spot? Maybe if I were to return to the crime scene, or maybe if I were to go over, find out wherever morgue you live in, I'll drop off your clothes for you.
I don't know. I left my girl at the hospital. I ran back down to pick up the package of Petty, and he kind of pauses. Oh, fuck.
Oh, you didn't.
Fuck, shit, fuck.
You didn't.
He starts
to pace
around the room. He kind of passes through a wall at one point, walks back in again, still going, fuck, shit.
You didn't realize. I see.
Why the fuck didn't I realize? Ah!
Well.
God damn.
I mean, it wouldn't be the first time this happened. I've been through this rodeo before. Have you ever heard of demonic possession?
What?
I've been possessed by a couple demons, a couple ghosts, a couple angry douchebags with Charlie Chaplin stashes. You know, they're not nice people, but I generally, you know, keep my... I've contacted the dead before. You're not the first. We can figure it.
Wait, you've been possessed before?
Yeah, it's not fun. It's bad. It's very bad.
You just kind of see him bite his lip, look at you, look up and down at you, and then he just runs at you. I'm just gonna cut back over to Eirnin.
Eirnin is enjoying a nice pizza with her girlfriend.
That's right. Well, it's now the following morning.
Yeah. No, I was just done.
Oh, I know.
Because I'm eating. Yeah, so what's going on?
So time has passed. Morning
really?
Has come. Shut the fuck up. Time has passed and morning is broken. I imagine Eirnin and Busey are just kind of spooning, or at least holding each other on the bed.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, at about 9-ish a.m., Busey starts kind of getting herself out of bed, trying to get her shit together. Your phone's been pinging for the last hour or so, messages-wise, but it's just been too comfortable, too nice just to stay there. Just enjoy the moment for a little while longer.
Very gay.
Shut the... I'm sorry, is it gay to want intimacy?
I mean, if it's between two women, yeah.
All right, fine. Technically correct. Ladies, is it gay to want to hold another woman? Wait. Right. fucking derailed me.
I'm very good at that.
Yeah, there's a couple more pings, then a couple more pings, then eventually your phone starts actually ringing.
I roll over and sort of bash at it until I can pick it up, and then throw it in front of my face and just stare at the screen and see who's calling me.
Yeah, you see it's Omid. It's the tech guy.
I pick up the phone and sort of start making myself upright in bed. No, hello?
Hey, Eirnin, how you doing?
I'm okay. I had a nice night. You know, how are you doing?
Doing okay, I guess. Clovis is planning something, and apparently he wants you here, but apparently the cops have been poking around town. One of the deputies came down here and very nearly started a fucking fight, but figured out that it was smart enough not to try and start shit, so we're okay here. We might reposition in a little bit just to make sure nothing happens.
Okay,
but yeah,
keep
Zach...
me posted on the location. I'll get dressed and head over. I'll see if I can get Beauty to come with me, but I don't know if I'm gonna rouse her from what she's in right now.
Don't worry, it's a down day today. No one's really focusing on too much apart from Trev and Zach. I'm all done on my end, but I should probably shoot some footage or something. Just feel free to stop by down at the track if you want to say hi, but I know Clovis is looking for you.
Okay, I'll head over.
Alright, catch you later.
Alright. So I checked my phone for any text messages. Is there anything unrelated to my little group of friends? Have I got anything about work stuff?
You actually do have a message from... Once again, have to... have actually got a text from Utsang the Carl, Uke's husband. Who just has texted you the words "call me,"
okay.
And there's
sorry, go on.
No, go ahead.
No, I was saying, I was gonna say, well, if I'm gonna call him, I'm not gonna call him inside with earshot of Busey, so I have to do that outside.
Okay, that's fair enough. Yeah, Busey's just kind of reheating some pizza.
Okay. I thought she was asleep, but sure.
Oh no, she got up maybe a little bit early before you.
Hmm.
But yeah, if you want to just step outside, you can call him.
First I say to BC that the guys want me to go over and help out on the flats or something. I'm not sure what it is. You going to be okay?
Yeah. You don't mind if I just help myself to some pizza and some beer, do you?
I think there's some beer in the fridge. There's always beer in the fridge because I don't drink it.
I was gonna head down and meet up with Omid at some point. I know he's still trying to figure out the GoPros.
Oh, we're filming this. That's exciting.
Yeah, we're gonna have to do a lot of editing to keep faces out. But yeah, we just want to get some like B-roll and shit like that.
Sounds fun. Well, I'll probably see you there, but I'm gonna head out early. So I walk out and I shut the door behind me. I start heading towards town until I'm like out of sight, and then I take the phone call to
Utsang.
Utsang, there we go. I call him.
Yeah, it gets like half a ring and then he picks up.
Oh god.
Yeah, he's like, oh, you got it. Eirnin, hey.
Hi.
So you've been around for the last overnight. You haven't gone anywhere or talked to anyone, have you?
About
Any cops showing up?
Not with me. I just spent the night with my girlfriend.
Did you see after you left the clinic? You know those... You know the STEM kids?
Oh, yeah.
The redhead and the other girl. Mm-hmm. Warren and Amalia. You didn't happen to see them afterwards, did you?
No. Last I saw them was when they waved goodbye at them in the hospital. And then we had our little conversation, and I waited outside for my friend to pick me up. That was then, yeah.
Because last night sheriff deputies came round. Because can't find the kids.
What?
Like, Carly's still at the clinic. She's accounted for, but the other two kids said they were going to walk back from the clinic back to where we were, and they didn't make it home. And now cops are just trying to get a timeline, work out who was where, and they want to talk with you. They've already talked with me, they've already talked with Uke. And, yeah, just wanted to give you a heads up. I think one of the deputies might be coming over to your address to collect you.
To collect me?
Look, I don't know. They're apparently not the only kid who went missing. I don't know if they just ran off into the dunes and got drunk or something, but... This is not the right time for this to be happening anyway. There's no good time, but everyone's fucking jumping on this.
Imagine the... Yeah, alright. Thank you for letting me know. Is there a search happening?
At the moment, Sheriff Lane's talking to their relatives. They're probably going to do some kind of search party in the next couple of hours, but it's still kind of up in the air. No one seems to know whose jurisdiction it should be. I think SLPD are trying to just send in everything they can.
But okay. Please keep me posted. I should be available more or less for the rest of the day. I mean, to contact. Jesus Christ.
Look, just hopefully they'll show up with a bit of sunburn. And
I mean, I did see some like random, like on the way like back towards up past yours, like there was some random dude like just on the side of the road. He was riding a kid's bike. Like a Barbie pink kid's bike. And he looked like strung out on like another level. And he could have been around where the... Who's riding the kid's bike? I don't know, he was very suspicious. I remember seeing him in the car.
You better save it for when they come over and talk to you. I've gotta go. They're pretty much sitting on the whole place for the moment until they can release the scene. So, I'll see you later. Just keep your eyes open and be careful.
Okay, thank you. Okay, the next thing I hang up, and the first thing I do is I want to check and look around and see if I see or hear any police coming my way.
Just scanning around from where you are, it's a big open space. You can kind of see a small portion of Kalip from where you are, just for the sheer fact that it's a pretty open valley. No blues and twos, no sirens or anything like that you can see. The sheriff's department tend to have like fairly rugged 4x4, so they can get over the terrain pretty easily, no cruisers. But you can't see anything heading towards you at the moment.
Mm-hmm. So... I immediately start heading back towards my cabin. And I start spam text. I start calling Busey.
Busey. Just there's kind of a rattling coming from inside the cabin, and Busey comes out the front of the cabin holding her phone and goes, "What?"
And I say, "Cops."
Fuck, okay. She just kind of runs back inside. pulls some jeans on, gets into some shoes, and kind of is out back out in about a minute. Okay, cool. Fuck. Why?
I walk inside and I grab my like folder of personal information and slip that into my satchel. I also put my laptop in there. I close all of the blinds and the curtains. I power off everything. What else do I do? I come out, close the door behind me, lock it, and then like just look at Busey and go, before I lock it, do you need anything else?
Nope. She just kind of pecks you on the cheek and goes, I'll see you later, and just starts fucking taking off down the hill.
I'm like, good on you, and then I walk around behind the trailer and just, you know, do my
disincorporate.
Shit.
Disincorporate, yeah.
Yeah, just fucking disappear. And head off. Can I get some aerial height, please?
Yeah, I'd say if you want to, I'd say, yeah, give me an invoke if you want to,
Yep. Invokes plus strange, right?
Yep.
Key. Roll again.
Actually, no, sorry, this would be an architect yourself.
Okay, where's that?
That's your main move. Give me plus range.
Where is architect yourself?
The first move on your left hand side.
Yeah. Okay, so that would be 9, 10. That's 11.
Oh, nice. So so temporarily raise one of your stats by one.
Mm-hmm.
Up to a maximum of plus 3. So maybe just put it in brackets next to whichever stat you want to raise.
Mm-hmm.
Are you just turning into like a ball of light, or are you just bending large around yourselves to just not look like anything?
I'm trying to be as hidden as possible, I guess.
That's fair enough. You wander lonely as a cloud. Come on, how many times can I make that shitty joke? And are you heading towards anywhere in particular, or are you?
I'm just a little black rain cloud, living underneath the honey tree. If you get that reference, you have a good childhood. You have a good childhood if you get it. Right, so what do I do? I'm looking, so I'm keeping an eye out, trying to spot any police movement first.
Yeah.
Do I see it?
At the moment, there's no real police presence. You can see there's a couple of cop cars outside the trailer park as you pass overhead. And you see, as you kind of start sweeping towards Kaleep, there's a couple of cruisers parked up. Like out right next to where the racetrack is starting to form and all the cars are starting to come up.
Mm-hmm.
And then just intermittently you can see the kind of tan hats of the deputies kind of patrolling around.
Okay. Is there any like, so I don't know how, like there's not any perception roles in this game, so I'm trying to think like, so I can't just go DM tell me stuff, which is hard.
Well, I mean, it's one of those things where if logically you'd just be able to, you'd be able to see it. Sure. If it's you want to find something really particular, then I'd find a role for it.
So, as I'm passing over, will I be able to see like the area around the clinic?
Everything's going to be a bird's eye view. But yeah, if you want to, yeah, I'd say you could just give me a reflect and do it with. I would honestly say. Well, I mean, honestly, like, are you just going to stay at an angle, or are you actually going to try and get in close and kind of hear as well as see?
Well, I'm not trying to find out what's going on with the police. I'm trying to see if I can see any overarching patterns or weird things from above. That,
then
like,
give me plus range.
Okay, so that's going to be... which type of role is this? Hunt.
So that's going to... not hunt, because that's a bit more damaging. This is going to be a reflect.
Mm-hmm. 6, 7, 8.
Okay, cool. So yeah, you're floating around. And yeah, do you just want me to give you some general information, or do you have a question you want to ask? Whatever information I give you will be pertinent to the story, but if you want something specific, I can give you a somewhat direct answer.
No, I'm gonna let you think about what you want to say.
Okay, so you're drifting you drift over the town of Kaleep and you make some passes over various buildings. As you go over the clinic, you don't really pick up much apart from the standard, like, slight crackle of radio that tends to come out of, like, public buildings which use shortwave radio. And as you kind of start swooping over the racetrack downtown, it's as you actually pass over where you know the Desert Spice restaurant is, you feel a very strange shift where a very familiar sensation washes over you of that sense of time and space not necessarily as bad as it was when you got pulled into wherever you went, but that same sense of everything being pulled thin, of this slight almost scabbing of reality. And it seems to be coming from at least the general vicinity of that particular restaurant.
Okay, can I do anything to, like, go closer in and see if they can see anything?
Yeah, you can, I mean, if you're bending light around yourself, you're pretty much fine as you are. You can just get closer as much as you like.
Do I sense it getting stronger as I get closer in, or is it consistent?
It definitely gets stronger.
Can I kind of, like, triangulate the position, almost?
It's pretty simple to do. As you get closer and closer, you get to about the second story of the building, and as you go lower, it starts to diminish. You raise yourself again and find yourself at the window of one of the bedrooms. And through the glass, you can see almost like a heat haze, some kind of shimmer to the air. And that feeling of space and time, feeling kind of coagulated, like something's trying to cover over a rend or wound, is very pronounced. And from it, or at least from the vicinity of it, you just hear a very distant, "Help!"
And, that's bad.
I think I'll jump back to Vic for a second.
Okay.
He ran at me before. So does that
fuck,
mean
I forgot that bit. I do apologize. Sorry, could you give me an invoke?
Yes.
Sorry, I completely forgot I did that.
All right, and it is the first die is 4, the second die is 2.
Cool. So that's a 6. Okay, yeah, that makes sense. So we're actually going to just mildly time skip. as Vic just gets body checked, and there is just this horrible sense of double vision and nausea as this figure turns itself inside you and sort of extends its limbs as that all too familiar feeling of something hijacking your body washes over you.
Jesus fucking Christ. What the fuck is this?
And yeah, you find yourself not speaking through your mouth, but now simply an inert voice inside your own head.
Jesus Christ. Can I go for another injection?
At the moment, you are... I'm just making a move
really
against you,
pain.
So...
I'm just in really huge pain right now.
Yeah, there is a moment, and then your body goes, "Man, you really like heroin. Fuck. Oh. Jeez, you treated this body like shit. Ugh."
Yeah.
It shudders.
Yeah, I did. You don't know at all what I go through, so why are you fucking judging?
Well, I'm judging because you stole my shoes, you stole my jeans, he says as he kind of pulls them back onto you, stuffing your feet in there, because, shit, yeah, they are a little small.
Alright, okay, fair enough, but, like, we can figure out a different way other than you jumping into my fucking body and elongating my arms and... You're destroying it worse than the heroin right now, you know that, right?
Well, I mean, he's not actually, like, bending your body.
Oh.
He's kind of, it's water going into a jug. It's not, it doesn't exert any more pressure than anything else.
Oh, my bad.
No, that's
either
cool.
It fucking hurts. And I prefer you not do it. Can you get out? We can talk about this.
Well, that's great coming from the guy who I've currently got stuck inside whatever passes for the fucking calcified peanut that is your brain.
Shit. All right. Well, you know what? Then we can wing it. But just be aware that if I don't get my shots and I get possessed by some random dickhead, then you are fucked.
Yeah, well, we'll cross that bridge when we come to it. Now, come on, I gotta go and see my girl.
Alright, let's...
Pulls the wardrobe away from the door, pulls the door open and starts walking outside. And, yeah, it takes him a while to kind of get used to walking. There's a kind of lurching, raised knee gait to him for a little while. If you've ever seen Men in Black, that just awkward lurch the big cockroach does in the man suit.
Right.
Not too far off of that.
I gotta ask, before we go, can I get my loot back that I hid in the...
I mean, you can ask him.
Alright, then I will ask if I can get my loot back, because it'll be useful, because, you know, I have a gun and money, you know, in case we need to do something.
You got money?
Yeah. He kind
of goes back over, finds the backpack. That's my shit, you thieving junkie bastard!
Oh, alright, you fucking relax, alright? It's called survival of the fittest.
He just goes, do I have to check to see if I've got both my nuts still attached to my corpse? What the fuck, man?
No, I didn't take your nuts. I did take the drugs.
Fucking...
I took the
drugs? Petty's gonna fucking shoot your ass. God damn.
Well, he didn't. apart from the clothes and the money that I helped myself to, he kinda told me to, you know, go to your body and find the shit and bring it to him.
I didn't have any money on my body.
Oh.
You motherfucker!
Oh, okay, well, I guess
you stole money from my trailer! You fucking piece of shit!
Wait, that was your trailer?
If you found the fucking stash, that means you had one half of the fucking RFID tag, which means the other half, which was already attached to my fucking stash in my fucking trailer, and there wasn't any cash in that, so you must have taken the fucking cash in my fucking trailer.
Wait, so who is the kid that I punched in the face?
You punched a kid in the face? Okay.
He had a baseball bat, and he charged in there. Look, I was told to get the shit out of your house. There were some complications. The kid came in with a baseball bat, and I just decked him in the face, and I started running.
Oh, my fucking God. Oh, my God. Why have I jumped into the body of the world's worst fucking crackhead? Sorry. Sorry. Fucking smackhead.
You know what?
This entire conversation is going on as he's lurching down the sidewalk.
You made some... I'm not the only one who made stupid decisions here, pal. You're the one who fucking jumped into me. We're both fucking stupid here.
Look, where did you put the fucking cash?
I stuck it along with the gun and some ammo in the hidey holes back of the apartment. The one that you left before I could get off a word about.
He kind of turns around, stomps back into the apartment.
Alright.
Where...
Hidey hole, left corner, underneath the floorboard.
Alright, he kind of prizes us up. You see him kind of crack a fingernail. Alright, fucking goddamn.
Hey, at least you still have a fingernail. I don't have any fingernails. I kept sucking the crack... I mean the heroin, I'm sorry. I get my drugs mixed up sometimes. I kept sucking the heroin out of the cuticles, so...
Fair enough. But yeah, he kind of looks at the backpack and goes, so you didn't take my... Wait... Did you or did you not take the cash in my fucking trailer?
Yeah, I did.
Where the fuck's that?
Oh, that's in the P.O. box. That's, I forgot. I stashed that there in case the rednecks were going to come after me. Why were you in the trailer park again? You don't seem like a trailer park
kind of guy.
Because
that's where I fucking live, you degenerate idiot.
Well, yeah, but you don't seem like an inbred kind of dude.
It's cheap and off the fucking grid.
Yeah.
Plus, my girl came from there, so it was, you know, a good deal on the trailer.
Okay, that's fair enough. All right, let's get the P.O. box cash then.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, he stomps back outside, and there is just this moment as he walks out of the apartment, turns to his left, and goes, "Oh, hey, Billy!" And there is just this ham-sized fist that swung directly into his and your face.
Well, I guess shall I roll?
Yeah. If you want to give me a at this point, I think just another invoke, see if you can get control again.
Alright, let me see. I have a 3 die and a 6 die.
So that's 9... in a second. But your strange is minus one, so that's an eight. So it's still fine. Cool. So you... There is like a... So there is a moment where you just lurch for control and the spirit also makes a bid to kind of keep you down. And there is just this moment as you thrash on the floor, one arm in your control, another arm in his control, like repeatedly grabbing each other's wrist, kind of trying to force the other one down to the ground. And this pantomime is kind of quickly cut short as more and more of these big beefy rednecks just kind of mass up around you, and you hear one of them up above go, "You hit him so hard he had a fucking seizure, man. What the hell?"
Jesus fucking Christ. Let me get in control of the body for a second, and then once we're safe, you can take back control if you want.
Oh, fuck, he's talking to himself. He's speaking in tongues. Get him!
Oh, and, fuck.
Yeah, there is just a flurry of boots. And eventually someone kind of grabs you by the scruff of the neck, hauls you up, and there is just nothing but a potato sack that's shoved over your head.
Well, shit.
Back over with Eirnin. So yeah, you have been presented with this strange rift.
That's pretty bad. So
yeah, you can hear a distressed voice coming from somewhere around it.
Okay. Is the window open?
The window is... So the window's not open, but there's an AC unit going into that room, and it'd be pretty trivial to just go through the AC unit.
Let's go...
So,
and I wiggle my phone through there. It's the only object that I carry.
This floating cell phone. Yeah. I mean, you can always just go in and then open the window.
Yeah, that also works. That's lame.
So yeah, are you going to reform or just stay as a nebulous thing?
Let's take a look around first, quickly. Is there a lock on the door?
So the door is at. The door has a lock on the inside, but it hasn't been locked. You can see it looks like there was someone who lived in this bedroom for a while, like lots of posters and all sorts of other stuff. But then a second person has moved their stuff in fairly recently.
Mm-hmm.
You see like a ThinkPad laptop, you see a bunch of mechanical manuals and some technical programming manuals as well. A couple of like a duffel bag for the clothes. And yeah, you actually even see there's a little kind of photo that's been put on the desk. It shows the kid you remember as Warren, the redhead, with an equally redheaded looking father and then a rather suffering looking mum.
Mm-hmm. So this isn't the house above the restaurant,
is it? This is the Dekal's home.
So what, and the redhead was one of the STEM kids.
Yeah, they told you last time that they'd basically given their eldest children's bedrooms over to the STEM kids as places to stay.
Oh, so that, okay, I understand now. Yeah. So, cool. I go over to the door and I lock it. Assuming the energy isn't coming from past the door.
No, you can kind of, as you kind of move around it, you can see that there is, it's almost like an elliptical, just haze in the world. And as you move around it, you can kind of get a rough idea of its shape. It's about 3 foot tall, about a foot wide, and that space in between it is just like pulled thin. Light doesn't pass through it in kind of an opaque, kind of frosted glass almost sort of way.
Yeah. Okay, so I'm going to go and lock the door.
Yeah, simple enough to do.
So I reform, I get on my phone, and I take a picture of this thing.
You feel a very gentle tug as you become more corporeal.
Well, that's not fun. Can I resist it?
Yeah, you can. Like it's very minor now. You feel, it's almost like someone covered a fan.
Okay, so I've taken a picture of this thing. Can I send a text message to Clovis explaining what I've seen so far?
If you want to. The picture comes through kind of... In fact... Yeah, I'd say don't even worry about rolling. You take a photo, and when you actually look at your phone again, you see something a bit startling. You see an after image of those two kids. Almost as if they are, like, just talking with each other.
Do I recognize the scene?
You can just kind of see, like, Warren is sat at the desk, Marlia is kind of sitting on the bed looking rather animated and saying something.
Okay,
and
I guess.
From your kind of vantage point, you can see that around them there is that same haze, and they are being gently kind of, like, they're almost like a smudge is pulling them towards it on the picture itself.
So I guess the next step is I'm gonna send a bunch of text messages to Clovis about this. Set my phone on silent, or like no vibrate, no nothing. And then I guess I'm gonna pull out my phone again, and I'm gonna open up the video camera. And then I'm gonna use that to see where they are in the room.
Yeah, you put it on video, and yeah, it's a surreal sight. You are almost walking around the room through the camera, taking in this singular frozen moment in time.
Okay, now I need to test some things. So, I make my finger, like, hot enough to, like, cause someone to flinch, but not hot enough to burn someone. Does that make sense? And who's the oldest of the two?
Marlia is most likely okay. The older. Warren's the youngest, so Marlia will be the older.
Okay, I'm going to poke her with my thingy finger, my hot finger.
Your hand just passes straight through.
But is there any reaction on the video?
No.
Okay, so I can't interact with them directly this way. I don't want to accidentally kill them is the problem.
If you want to think about it, I can hop back to Vic.
No, you can give me one moment. I'm trying to think of... I've got a really dumb idea.
Go for it. Like I said, unless I say mortal danger, you cannot be killed.
Yeah, but I don't want to get the kids killed. Which is, I think, a possible outcome here. If they're not already dead, that is. Okay, can I pick up, like, a pencil off the desk or something?
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, without... I'm not going to have fingerprints in this situation for obvious reasons.
No. You just have flesh nubs.
Yeah. And I'm going to drop the pencil into the vortex thing.
I mean, it's kind of like a vertical slice, so you'd probably just throw it.
Yeah. Oh, I see what you mean. Yeah, okay.
Yeah, you throw it and it just kind of slows, and then there's a little black hole appears where the pencil was, and there is now just this tiny little Vanta black dot standing in the middle of the room, and you can feel that suction kind of heighten a little bit.
Ooh, that's not fun. Okay, I'm going to do a little bit more testing.
You do actually hear, like, someone just distantly go, "Someone there?" And it's a little louder. And you're almost certain you hear an engine revving.
Ooh. Okay. I'm going to do more ill-advised fiddling.
You pull out a violin. Time for a hoedown.
So I want to test if this thing is, like, how this thing works. So, let's kind of... I disconnect, like, a part of myself into, like, a separate thing. Like a little burning ball of hotness stuff. Essentially a fireball, but very, very, very small, like the size of a marble. And I kind of pass that through the slit to see what happens.
Give me an invoke.
Cool. That's strange, right?
Yep.
Fighting my computer, hold on. Where is it in book? Let's see what the effects of this is. So, 5, 6, 8. That's a 10.
Okay, so you get to pick 2. So you can wield your power efficiently and precisely.
One and three.
Okay, so yeah, you pass this small ball of fire in there. And as it approaches the edge of the hole, it kind of spaghettifies. It gets longer and longer and thinner until there is just this blazing, almost white line. It kind of radiating from just beyond the tip of your finger into the hole, and it starts to kind of hit this event horizon, and you get this sense of incredible distance, but without actually going anywhere at all. And as the are you still like retaining feeling as you go through as the ball kind of enters?
Sure, why not?
Yeah, as you kind of as the fire starts to pass through the actual hole itself, you feel something truly bizarre. You actually see two places at once.
Wild.
In your right eye, the best your brain can understand it, you are here. You are in Kaleep in 2019, and everything is exactly as you saw it a second ago. Your left eye, this room is completely different. There are some fairly traditional looking Nepalese wall hangings and a much rougher looking bed. And in the corner of your eye, you see outside, the time of day is completely different.
Wild.
And through your left ear, you hear some big band or swing music playing.
Is it recognizable?
Not particularly. It's quite distant and kind of generic.
Okay. This is fun.
And you feel this tug coming. Not an aggressive tug.
On
it's not
which end?
On the left hand, on the other place.
A tug pulling me where?
Towards that, away from where you are now.
Well, no time like the present.
Dabs on reality. Yeet!
I start kind of floating my little floating flame eyeball, my flame servitor.
yes, the Mechanicus have truly blessed us this day.
Yeah. Servos goals. And I kind of slip out through, as I look for a way out of the room. Is the window open or anything? Or is there like somewhere I can just,
Like I said, you can pop the window open fairly easily. It's got a latch on the inside.
But I'm a ball. I can't really do that. Not really got enough energy to
do
anything.
The rest of
really
your body is still the rest of your body is still a body.
Yeah.
As the fire. Yeah. If you want to go any further in here, you're gonna have to give more of yourself. You're gonna have to kind of not fully submit, but definitely open yourself up to this pull.
Okie dokie. I guess I'm gonna look around the room. Can I look out the window without giving up anymore?
You can turn your head, and yeah, you get the feeling like turning your head here is turning of you in wherever else you are.
Okay, so it's like bad VR. Cool.
Yeah, there's a kind of a weird lag to it almost. And as you turn your head through the window, you do see like rather gaudy looking American like red, white and blue bunting on the building across the street, and hanging from a banner is Nobel Speed Flats 1944. See the world's fastest car.
I put two and two together and go, that's interesting. Oh dear. I guess that wasn't the hallucination. Then that means, okay, would I have recognized Mr. Hobo, or Vic Hobo Man, from the time that I saw him riding the bike? What should I roll for that?
I would say for the sake of maybe allowing you to put some plot-relevant information together, don't worry about rolling.
Okay.
Yeah, you kind of blink, you kind of flat twig, hang on a second. That weirdo on the bicycle was the same weirdo I saw walking out into the salt flats. That's interesting. I wonder if he saw the same thing I saw.
I need to find this fucker. I sort of edge my I edge real fast, and then I...
That's not edging at all.
Depends on your baseline.
Oh, God.
No, I come back through the portal. Does that work?
So you're going to pull back from it?
Yes.
You are going to want to give me... Yeah, I'm going to say just give me another invoke to actually withdraw from it safely. Because as you kind of begin to try and pull back, you realize it's kind of like a finger trap.
If I
simple enough to push in, hard to pull back out.
If I use burning at both ends, is that like...
So you take a +1 on this roll, and you take a negative 2 on the next one. But
is that after I rolled?
No, before.
Sure, and I'll try and bait you into rolling something dumb. Yeah, okay, I invoke... Yeah, I invoke burning at both ends.
Okay, so you can be rolling at a +3 if you're doing strange.
Yes. So roll again. 4, 5, 6. That's a 9.
Okay, cool. So I was going to say, since this is pretty much a singular action you're trying to do, it's probably not going to be too much of a problem as to which options you pick.
Okay.
So.
Yeah.
Yeah, you definitely feel the resistance, but you're able to just pretty much just brute force and withdraw yourself from it. And yeah, okay. As you pull away, you see that you've made the hole a little bigger, and there is just this kind of scratching. But as you watch, these little tendrils start to come from the edges of the hole and start sewing it back up, as if reality is trying to heal itself. As the adage goes, it'll never get better if you pick at it. Cool.
I'm gonna make a really stupid inference. I'm gonna make a really stupid inference.
Go for it.
What's the largest object in the room I could comfortably like put lift? Is it like a radio? I mean,
you could pick
a
chair up. Yeah, there's a chair you could pick up fairly comfortably.
I throw a chair through the portal.
Okay, sure. You throw this chair through the portal.
And I ready, like, getting the fuck out.
Now, you see, I told you that this rift was about a meter tall. Sorry, yeah, about 3 foot tall, about a foot wide. The chair just kind of tumbles into it, and the hole it knocks is so much bigger than that. And the void just snatches you.
Can I resist?
No.
Can I resist with euphoria?
I'm going to say no.
You fucker.
Again,
turn into
like,
the sun.
A lot,
you're like,
your
nah,
powers. See, this is the problem. Your powers are entirely rooted in this reality.
Ah, shit, yeah, it's good. See, here's the problem. Can I explain to you my logic behind
you
this?
You punched
decision?
A hole right through the fabric of reality.
My logic behind this decision was this, right? You said that the hole was stitching itself back closed. Mm-hmm. I saw originally that throwing stuff through made the hole bigger.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And I didn't want to have a situation where the hole disappeared and I couldn't get through to find wherever if the kids had gone through there. So I wanted to be able to go and find Vic and come back. So I thought, like, if the pencil, like, made it, like, a tiny bit bigger, then the chair might make it, like, I don't know, like,
it
3 meters or something?
Yeah, it's just, you should... I will just say again, peeling back the screen for a second here, if a 3-foot-tall, 1-foot-wide gap could suck 2 people in without any resistance whatsoever, knocking a much bigger hole would make it even harder.
Okay, yeah, that was stupid.
Go through, you see a bed go through, you see a wardrobe come through with you.
Oh, that's fun.
So a small black hole has opened up in some kid's bedroom.
I'm really good at, like, just fucking things up.
Meanwhile, in the redneck kidnap van...
I almost met up with you. I tried.
Don't worry, I'm getting there. Yeah, there is just been a flurry of fists and feet thrown at Vic for the last 10 minutes straight.
Just while I've been doing all that shit,
if Vic, you want to mark your essence down by 1, bring it down to 3.
Yeah, let me find that real quick. Essence.
So, bottom of the first page.
Current essence,
left-hand side.
Or might bring it down to 3. Alright.
Yeah. So, yeah, you are beaten, blooded, bruised, and you haven't been kind of bound necessarily, but your pockets have been turned out, and your head has been completely encased by this horrible, stinking burlap sack. And after about half an hour of being jostled around in this truck, you feel hands grab you by the armpits, haul you out, and then just throw you into the ground, dust just erupting all around you. And you just hear from around you a lot of activity, a lot of muffled talking, and a lot of angry raised voices that all kind of blend into another. And sure enough, a moment later, someone grabs the sack, pulls it up from your head, and just sunlight blares down on top of you.
Well,
and
shit.
Yeah. And standing in front of you, you see 3 people. You see a woman, maybe in her early 40s, just wearing like a Guns N' Roses t-shirt and some cut-off jeans. Just, you can see her eyes are red from crying. She's kind of cuddled up in the arms of another guy who's maybe about 7-8 years her senior, big mutton stash, otherwise completely bald, who's glaring down at you with obvious fucking contempt, holding a sawn-off shotgun in the crook of one arm. And just to the left of those two, you see the spirit that had been occupying you earlier, who's just watching this with every bit of fucking glee on his face.
Ah, I see. He's going to be one of those kind of people. All right.
And, yeah, the big bald guy just looks around at everyone, and you can immediately see as he kind of gets their attention that everyone else falls quiet, he's probably one of the big, big swinging dicks around here.
All right.
He kind of hunkers down next to you, handing the shotgun off over to someone else. Goes, "Your name, Vic?"
Sadly, I'm no one else. This is the birth name I was stuck with.
You robbed that trailer over there?
Well, yes. Unfortunately, you were a target
No, that man was a friend of mine.
Well, according to your entire clan that was chasing me down, yes. I kind of figured that.
Part of me wants to just fucking do this and bury you out in the fucking flats, but...
Well, you'd be doing me a service. But I know you're not gonna...
What did you do with Billy?
Billy?
My fucking son.
Oh, you mean the kid with the baseball bat that I fucking decked in the head and just left there as I ran away?
What did you do with him?
I just told you, I decked him in the face, and then I hightailed it out on that nice pink bicycle.
You can kind of... He takes in a deep breath, and you can see that this is a man who is holding on to his temper, but that temper is just welling up inside him. He looks over his shoulder, and the woman is just putting her hand over her mouth.
Look, I'm being legit. I'm not trying to fuck with you or nothing. I'm not trying to be a sarcastic smartass. I'm not even in the position to do that. If I knew what happened to Billy, you and your intimidating daddy gut there would smash me, and I don't feel like being smashed. Not by another dude, at least. You know what I'm saying? So I don't know what happened to your son, but I did the guy with the baseball bat, I did deck him once in the face, but afterwards I ran towards the bike and hightailed it.
He kind of looks up over your shoulder at someone else, and you just kind of hear from behind, "I mean, he did take off like straight away."
Exactly. I just needed the money for the fix, man. I just need it for the fix. That's it. I don't have enough time to fucking diddle around and fuck off and have a tea party in your friend's house.
He just straightens up, motions for a couple of them to come up from behind you and lift you up again. He goes, "You're gonna show me."
Show me? Oh, are you just... No, there's nothing to show. I didn't do nothing.
And they just start dragging you over towards the trailer.
Look, buddy, there's nothing to show. I literally just ran.
As you get closer, you start feeling this tension headache start welling up in your head. I'm going to start compelling your mark.
All right.
As you just start to feel this real fucking, like, hot stink of burnt tires.
Oh, God. All
right. Start to well up around you again.
Buddy, listen. All right. You don't like me very much right now, and I know you're not. But you gotta listen to me here, all right? Please, look. There was some drugs, all right? I know you flipped it out. You can keep the money, but just give me something. Please.
Fucking, he just growls, steps, climbs into the trailer. It's like, you were in here, and you beat my boy, and you did fucking something. You did something,
because
he ain't here anymore. You were the only man to lay hands on my boy.
And you know what?
I should fucking snatch the life out of you for what you did.
And you know what? I would agree with you in your position, but I also promise you that I only punched him in the face and ran.
As you're dragged up the steps into the trailer, that stink of burning tires gets just more and more pervasive until it's over your tongue, down the back of your throat.
Look, man, you want information? I'll help you out. I don't know what happened to your son, but I'll fucking find him for you. But I need that fix, or else bad shit's gonna happen. I don't mean that as a threat either. That's more of a detriment to me than you. Actually, it could be a detriment to you. But look, it'll help us both out if I get that fixed, man. Trust me. You need to trust me here.
You want a fucking fix?
Yeah. Don't fix my jaw with your fist. Just the fucking drugs. There were drugs. I have heroin. I'm a heroin addict. See the track marks? Help me out, and I'll help you.
He motions to the two guys, and just inside the trailer, the mess has not really been tidied up all that much. The dresser is still knocked over. The bedroom is still a complete mess. And he motions for the two other guys holding you to kind of hold your arms out. And then he just pulls this big fucking claw hammer from the back of his pants.
You're gonna make a bad mistake.
You're not gonna be able to shoot fucking anything. And he reaches out, grabs you by the front of the shirt and pushes you, and this stink of burnt tires washes over you.
Can I give in to the mark? Because at this point, I don't think I'm going to be getting out of here. Not with big, beefy redneck.
Everything goes black.
Okay.
And suddenly there's light. But it's not... It doesn't feel like real sunlight. It feels like a fluorescent, like being under a heat lamp almost.
Okay.
And Eirnin, also, you find yourself on a quite dusty, kind of badly tarmacked road, looking out over the town of Kalip. And next to you is a disheveled, bloodied, and thoroughly kicked in the fucking face looking heroin addict that you recognize from a purloined Barbie bicycle.
Welp.
Fuck. I don't even know what the fuck. What's going on?
Well.
And there's kind of a crackle of feedback from some kind of PA system, and with a kind of reverb that rolls out around the hills. Yeah.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back. It is the 1944 Kalip Speed Trials, sponsored by Nobel Oil. Come one, come all, come down to the pits and take a look at the Larkspur, the world's fastest land vehicle. Get ready, folks, because we're about to break records all day long.
Ah, shit. What the fuck is this? What do those fucking inbreds do to me, dude?
Do I see anything, or is it black void and we're just hearing this?
You find yourself standing in a fairly dusty tarmacked road, maybe about 500 yards away from Kalip. And when you look out of it, you realize it's much smaller. There's way less build-up. There's no trailer park. There's Most of the, like, more modern buildings you remember from, like, the old clinics and everything aren't there at all. Only, like, Main Street and a smattering of other houses around the main drag still exist. Although you do recognize the same nice teal paint job from the Desert Spice restaurant. But as you look around, you see people moving around, you see a lot of life, a lot of hustle and bustle. And it's as your vision tracks further and further into the distance that it hits you. The sky and the horizon don't meet. And in the gap where there should be, there is just nothing. And as you look around, you realize that all around you, maybe for like a couple of square miles, there is something. And beyond that is just nothing.